I guess I'll begin, and I'll start by telling you how I became acquainted with Freedom Firm. And it started probably over 14 years ago, close to 15 years ago. I became acquainted with a band called Aradhana, which is Hindi for adoration. I went to a music festival in Bushnell, Illinois called Cornerstone, and I saw a little seminar that was called Hindu Devotionals versus Christian Devotionals. And I thought, that's kind of curious, so I went to check it out. And it was led by Chris Hale, the singer, and Peter Hicks, the guitarist. And before I experienced their music and I bought one of their albums, Indian music to me was chaotic. It sounded crazy. Culture was just really, really foreign in the strongest sense of the word. And when I listened to the album, what it did for me, because it was a blend of Western sounds and Eastern sounds and traditional Indian folk music, it became a bridge that allowed me to cross over into this space where I could appreciate and fall in love with the inherent beauty and the culture and the language and the music. And so through that relationship, I slowly began to build over time by seeing Aradhana when any chance I got to see. They would often sell jewelry like the ones that you're seeing at their concerts. And somewhere along the line, I got a call from one of my best friends from undergrad, a guy named Chris Deering, and he called me while I was at school, and he's like, dude, you know Peter and Fiona Hicks from Aradhana? Like, yeah. He's like, they're our landlords. I'm like, what? And so I drove home that at the end of that semester by way of Cincinnati to Cleveland. I spent a week there, and the first night I'm there, I was sitting in the house of Peter and Fiona Hicks, two of the members of one of my all-time favorite bands. We're eating curry, sipping on wine, and listening to Louis Armstrong, and I think this is like the coolest moment of my life. And when Chris asked Pete and Fiona, I was like, oh wait, you guys are in Aradhana? Do you know Spence? They said, oh yeah, we know Spence. And Chris laughed. He's like, that sounds about right. He's like, if Spence likes your music, you will know about it and you will have to like it. So I became introduced through that. And the funny thing is that the way Aradhana's music just opened my heart up to India, it reopened up, you know, buried desires that got placed in me towards mission. And I think it was one of the main things that brought me here to seminary. And that and a friendship with a friend who went to Kenya, that just God used all these things. And that's why I'm standing here talking about Freedom Firm. And the other crazy thing I just found out only recently is that one of the co-founders is this older sister of Peter from Freedom Firm. And so there's all these crazy connections that have keep coming up. And what Freedom Firm does, just a basic summary, is they rescue girls from sex trafficking in India. And to start a presentation properly, we're going to show you guys a video. It's a trailer from a documentary that Peter helped push for and Aradhana did a lot of the music for. And that's called Horse and Rider.
So I was introduced to Freedom Firm by Dr. Spence here, and and again, they're working mainly in sex trafficking and providing justing and healing in India. And now we're going to provide their mission statement. We actually pulled this statement. They have multiple versions of it. We pulled this off of a 990, which is, I think, a nonprofit IRS tax form. So this is what they wrote, what they do to the IRS, essentially. I'm not going to read to you, but some of the key things is they identify, and we'll go into how they do all this later on. They restore, and they work in the law to prosecute. And now Spence is going to explain why this has happened in India.
Okay, one of the first things you probably saw was statistics in the video. And in that video, what you see is that there is a massive amount of number of underage girls who are trafficked in India. And here it shows you that it's 25% of an estimated 500,000 minor girls in India alone. And the U.S. State Department even says it calls India the source, destination, and transit country for majority trafficking in Asia. So the need for rescue in India is paramount. It's enormous. It is a huge problem. It's almost overwhelming. And one of the things that you would see if you ever get a chance to watch the documentary is that the way we can grapple with these things is we start with one person. And that's the first thing, is we have to find that one person. And that's where we go. We go into rescue. We find that one person that we know is underage, that is being trafficked. And we're going to move into the section of rescue right now.
Yeah. I just want to add one thing. Their emphasis is minor girls, so under the age of 18. And one of the big issues in India is the caste system and kind of the Hindu worldview that these girls have been born into this life, and this is the life they've been handed. And that's another reason why India is such a key part, is that these girls actually believe that this is what they're supposed to do, in a sense. So now we're going to talk about, begin their three-step process, sort of like Children of Promise. They have a threefold kind of process that they go through. In order to do that. And first is rescue, and so they start with undercover investigation. They're actually hiring some undercover investigators if anybody wants to go do that. But they go into the brothels, the red light districts with undercover cameras, and try to identify young women. An issue they run into is that girls lie about their age. Either they've been told to by the brothel keepers, threatened, whatever, they're lying about their age. So it's really hard to identify. And after that, they kind of document and form some evidence, and then they go to the police and report crime, in a sense, and then they try to help with raids. And there's obviously corruption and other issues that we'll get into a little bit later to deal with that, and working with the government and the local police. And then again, the criminal complaints that hopefully go into the court system and eventually lead to trials and prosecution.
I'm going to talk a little bit about restoration, and one of the first things that happens in the rescue process is there is a social worker with Freedom Firm, from Freedom Firm, or working alongside with Freedom Firm, that is immediately with the girl. One of the things that, in talking to Mala, the wife and co-founder of husband and wife that started Freedom Firm, is that these girls have like no education. They don't know how to articulate feelings. It's as if they're, you know, elementary as far as maturity and development. So they're right at the beginning, there's someone alongside in the rescue process. So one of the things we found in their threefold ministry of rescue, restoration, and justice is that they're not neat little categories, that they intersect and are woven together. And if you want to talk about holistic ministry, that's a huge part. Because things aren't bifurcated in separate sections, but they're interwoven. I'm already there. So immediate relationship with social worker, relational counseling. So a social worker, depending on the distance where the girl is placed in a government house, is once a week or once a month will travel to meet with the girl and to keep a relationship going. And any mental care that's needed is provided. They move towards education to bring these girls up, to give them education. And also employment. So most of them have no concept of a work ethic or how to approach a job. So they bring them into this space where they can learn about working an 8-hour day and all of the things that that entails. One of the ways they do that is through Rubama designs. And again, the process of coming alongside for counseling and relational counseling happens in this process as they bring these girls through this jewelry making kind of entrepreneurial approach. And I think, and I can't remember, found out what Rubama means in its Hebrew.
Then I forgot, yeah.
You forgot,
well, it's
okay.
It's the name that God gives Hosea's daughter. Okay. And it's like, I mean, there's compassion, mercy, but the reason they chose that is kind of the whole identity issue that they deal with the girls. So.
Yeah. And so if all of you guys, like, look at your jewelry that you have right now, if you look on it, you will find that there is a name for the girl that specifically made that piece of jewelry. And I think it's really important, because a lot of these issues can seem so distant, to realize that there is a kind of neighborhood, even if it's thousands of miles away, there's a closeness, especially with the way technology has brought us together and the ability to travel. So maybe if some of you guys could just tell me what some of the names are that you see on your jewelry. If anyone just...
Deepa.
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 You?
Manjula.
You find it?
This one
doesn't. He doesn't have names? Okay, some of them might not have names. So, this is an interesting process, too, to make jewelry, because what you're dealing with is actually bringing beauty into the context. It's not just learning entrepreneur's skill, but the process of making something beautiful, and then also caring for them along in that process. So you have a lot of things happening within that process of learning a skill, but also being exposed to beauty and showing that you deserve to be able to do this kind of work that is so much more than just selling your own body, but creating something beautiful, being told that you're beautiful. Get the next one. Another one of their ministries is through Leg Up India, which is an extension of Freedom Firm, and it uses horse therapy. And some of the girls will go on to actually work at the horse therapy farm, and a lot of times they'll work with mentally disabled kids, and that's an amazing thing. One of the things I've found from listening to other people's stories of doing missions, whether it's Rich Mullins or my friend Kimmy, she went to Kenya, and she said that the way these kids love is amazing, and it's really healing my broken heart. And I think one of the things we find is that if we feel like we're going to go and help and save people, a lot of times we're the ones that need saving. And in this process, what I found that the way God seems to work is that when we try to arrange for our own wounds, it never quite works. But giving these girls something to care for begins to further that process of God healing themselves. When we arrange for other people's wounds, we found our own wounds are healed. And I just recently learned like a physiology with the way horses walk and being with horses. If there's damage in someone's legs, that can help rejuvenate the person. There's so many things that play into this. And the obvious one would be creation, bringing creation into this process. And that extends also into a third arm of what they do for restoration is avalanche. And they'll take the girls out camping. And most of them have only been in the city. They've only been in these little cubby holes that have enough room for a mattress, where I think they said like 20 to 30 different.
Yeah, we heard in our interview.
Men will come.
A girl averages 20 customers a day. So.
And to take them out of the environment, to take them into nature, to show them beauty again, bringing beauty and creation And also there's the act of creating, you know, restoring God's image through that impulse that we are all designed to reflect the, for reflect God through creation, through creating. The creative impulse is very important.
Yeah, and I'll add that going back to the economy part, or poverty is a huge issue. And a lot of girls get rescued, but then they don't have a way to make money, so they just go right back into prostitution. So that's one way that Freedom Firm is addressing the poverty issue. And then the documentary is kind of specifically geared towards the horse ministry, right?
Yes.
So that documentary focuses on that, that aspect of their ministry.
This is Mala. Mala was rescued by Freedom Firm in 2007 after investigators found her in the red light district of Pune, a city in western India.
My name is Mala. Udhar se acha nahi lagta wo dhanda mein. फिर इधर आया तो थोड़ा अच्छा लग रहा है रोज वासी क्योंकि मैं पहले के जिंदगी में अच्छी नहीं आता अभी सब कुछ परमेश्वर के बारे में सब कुछ सोचता है उसका आगे बढ़ सकते हैं हम लोग को उसका आगे उसका धारा चल सकते हैं उसका जैसा हम लोग कभी छोड़ के नहीं जा सकते कंप्यूटर सीखने का और स्कूल का आगे बढ़ सकते हैं
So I guess you could call Mala a success story. And you're probably wondering where the gospel is, but you can hear it, that, that it's in there. We'll talk more about the issue with the gospel kind of in our critique, if you will. And I think she was one of the first girls rescued, right?
I believe so, yeah.
One of their first rescued girls that went through kind of everything. So and she's kind of like the face of the franchise. She's in a lot of videos and all that. But that's a neat story. So. Now we're going to talk about the justice process, and their purpose in that, as you can see up there, is to fight kind of the, and create systematic change in India. And this is a tough part of their job, I think, because there's a lot of things going on, and India is a whole other world. And so kind of the first thing they do, Spence, if you want to go to the next slide. And this goes back to their investigation, and like Spence mentioned, this whole process. We present it as linear, but it's really just all mixed together. So with their investigation, they're able to build a case, and they have formed relationships with what they call local advocates, which are lawyers and police chiefs, and a number of different organizations in India that they work with to take these cases to court. So they're working with prosecutors in that, in the court system, and in India is obviously a lot different than ours, and so there's corruption. One issue they face with law enforcement is that their salaries are super low, so they're easily bought off by a brothel keeper or somebody else to actually protect the brothel rather than enforce the laws. And India actually has really good laws that Mala told us were left over from the British influence there. And so they have these really good laws against underage prostitution, sex trafficking, all that stuff, but they're rarely implemented. And so that's one of their major focuses, too, is trying to see these laws actually played out, because the system has it, but they're not being used. So that's a big part of it. And then they're trying to get full conviction. And with each conviction, they've had 9 total, and they have about 100 trials in courts right now. With each conviction, it affects kind of the whole system of sex trafficking in India. Prices go up. It's deterring other brothel keepers and things like that. So, and then even an arrest and no trial, it affects the brothel keeper who's been arrested. A lot of times brothel keepers are able to walk away with no trial and things like that. And this kind of leads to prevention. We were kind of wondering where prevention comes in, and you can see it in this process. There may not be an overt attempt at it, but through prosecuting and arresting and all that, brothel keepers are prevented. And they only spend 7 to 8 years in prison, which doesn't seem like enough for me, but that's kind of their justice system. And again, it shows how all of it works together. A lot of the girls are brought in to testify against their brothel keeper, which seems incredibly intense to me, but it's kind of part of their healing process from what we've read and understood through conversation. So that's kind of their three-step process, if you will, that's really intertwined and incredibly holistic to us. And now we're going to show you a video that we could have showed you at the beginning and then just sat down and been doing our presentation. But it's an interview type setting with the co-founders, so they're going to talk more and it'll recapture and probably say things we didn't say. So.
We know that girls are trafficked because they're promised jobs. And we know that girls are trafficked when they're abducted. We also have heard a lot that girls are trafficked by family members. There's communities called Bedia communities where historically they have been putting their women into prostitution in order to provide for the rest of the family. The girls grow up knowing that they're destined to be a prostitute. When they're rescued, they are really confused because they say to us, "What are you rescuing me from? This is what I'm supposed to do. This is what I'm meant for." And then the fourth thing is girls are trafficked because they fall in love, promised marriage, and they go along with their fiance. And then he sold the girl when she got to the big city, to Pune or Mumbai. Whenever we go to the police and ask them to do a rescue, we play the role of leading them to the location primarily and identifying the girl and the brothel keeper. We never go without the police. So during a raid, there's built-in protection because we're going along with a police force. The danger levels change when it comes to the investigation because the investigation is totally done by Freedom Firm, independent of the law enforcement agency. And our investigators, young men who are going into the areas pretending to be customers, do have to be very careful. But their objective is to go in, leave if there's no young girls. If there is, engage the young girl, get as much information as they can from her. They're always wearing undercover cameras, so everything is documented, everything is recorded. And that's actually first and foremost for their own protection and their own accountability, and to identify who the brothel keeper and brothel manager are. Once you've found a young girl, is to find who's the person that's exploiting her.
Of our girls are HIV positive, and so teaching girls, you know, what that disease looks like, how do you self-care in that situation. The girls we rescue are completely uneducated, typically. Most wouldn't have even been to kindergarten. And so just learning to read and write in any language, not just English, but their own language, beginnings of literacy, learning how to add, subtract, use a pair of scissors and cut a straight line, just a lot of practical ways of being with the girls and teaching them. And then I developed the leg up program. Horse therapy was just this really tangible way of bringing a horse, and they get to ride and groom the horse and interact with the horse and also other disabled children, and not focus on themselves so much. In learning how to trust an animal, learning how to love something else, we saw little steps in being able to counsel them, relate it to real life situations. And probably the biggest way that we see rehabilitation for these girls is through a job. What are your skills? What skills do you need to learn? And how can you be successful in the world outside of the brothel? How can you survive? And so we do that through the platform of Ruhama Designs, which is the business that Freedom Firm runs, and the girls make jewelry. They'll learn computers, they'll learn how to upload photos, they'll learn how to take photos. They can learn different parts to manage the business. They'll help me in designing the products, packaging, all kinds of aspects of real business. And so our challenge is, how do we bring these girls from a place of brokenness into reality of what a real employer would expect? And so that when they leave us, they're not just gonna fall back onto, well, the only thing I can do is go back to the brothel. And if you look at any organizations that are working with these girls across the world, that's the biggest challenge.
there's lots of ways that you could combat trafficking, but probably the most effective is to hold the perpetrators accountable. So when you can catch a brothel keeper who has been forcing a minor girl into prostitution, living off her earnings, abusing her, and you can bring that brothel keeper before a court and actually get a prison sentence, and that brothel keeper spends time behind bars, you have stopped that brothel keeper from being able to exploit more children. But you've also done something far more significant than that even, is that you have sent a message to all the brothel keepers. And the message is, if you exploit minor girls, you're gonna spend time in prison. You're gonna spend time behind bars. So there's a multiplying impact, putting even one brothel keeper behind bars.
These two girls, their stories were told in the film Horse and Rider, and I believe it was this girl who had went through prostitution. She was married and severely abused by her husband, and at one point she tried, I think a couple times, to try committing suicide. And one of the ways she tried committing suicide was to cover herself in, I think, gasoline. But for whatever reason, she couldn't get the fire started, which is pretty amazing because gasoline is very flammable. And so there's amazing things and amazing even miracles like that happening in relationship to Freedom Firm. And one of the more amazing ones is we heard just found the story recently happened where two guys went
crazy.
In.
Yes. Go ahead. Sorry.
What's it?
Just what you're about to say is just insane. So.
Two guys go in and they go in to get they're going there to get a girl, to get a prostitute. And they were saying they really didn't want to be there. And for whatever reason, they went out and they left and they Googled and found Freedom Firm and helped get the girls rescued. Now, there are more layers to the story, but one of the aspects of it was is that one of them was in love with one of the prostitutes and wanted to get her out of there so he could marry her. And the latest update that Mala just sent me last night was that they were able to look at the family situation and realize it wasn't safe. So they have them in government housing and have kept them safe from those guys who, you know, it's like, what you meant for evil, God meant for good. It's just, it's bizarre. I mean, you think about, you know, the work of the Spirit through some of these things. It's just amazing. And I think our biggest critique was probably, where is the theology on all that? And maybe want to talk about that.
And so, like, you know, coming through their website and listening to some of their stuff that they say, there's not overt theology, right? There's not overt gospel. But you hear in, like, restoring identity. You saw it in Mala's interview. And so, like, we called to find out what they do with that. And so I'm talking to Mala, another Mala, who's one of the co-founders you saw in that video. And so I ask her, you know, how do y'all use the gospel? And she's like, I can't answer that over the phone. I think my phone's tapped.
This is where he got her almost arrested.
Yeah, so like the whole time I'm talking about, oh no, there's going to be a police raid, they're going to arrest her right now. But with the political landscape in India, they have to be very careful about the use of the gospel. You know, it's changing, persecution is on the rise. And so we were able to have a conversation with Keith, who works at their U.S. office. They have a U.S. office that does awareness, work with local churches, Lions Club, Rotary Club, to raise awareness and involve them in the ministry. And Chris talked more about it. And so everybody that works at Freedom Firm signs a profession of faith that they are Christian. All their offices, all their locations start each day with Bible study and devotion. And then their point is to lead these girls to Christ and restoring their identity as children of God. He was able to articulate that. Whereas in India, they can't necessarily because of the political landscape. And all the employees believe that this is their call. Jesus Christ has called them to work in this environment, and they're living out that call by loving these girls. So the gospel is there. Originally, we were like, where is it? You know, we know it's there, but how do they really do it? So we were able to find that out a little bit more through interviews, but this is a dangerous place for Christians right now in India. So
yeah,
they have to be very careful. The website doesn't really have anything about the gospel. They have a pray section where you can get involved and pray, but in terms of how they're using the gospel, it's not there. But
And they're very intentional about prayer. They have a time sign set up where every week people gather at wherever you are at that time. So it's not like, please pray for us. They have a space that they create where people are invited into that. And like you said, the nationalist Hindu party has really come into power, and I think the president is a nationalist Hindu. And in some places in India, like Orissa, it's extremely volatile. Pastors have been pulled out, have been murdered, limbs broken. Back in 2008, there was a big uprising because a Hindu leader was assassinated, and they blamed the Christians, and it was another religious group. And they went on a rampage and murdered hundreds, and they burnt down orphanages with Christian orphanages with children in them, all kinds of crazy things. So when it comes to criticizing the theology of an organization like this, that's in this kind of setting, you know, we want it to be very, very gentle with that. But they do a lot of this very low to the ground, under the radar, as much as possible.
Yeah. So a couple other things that we saw, you know, we saw that poverty is an issue. So how are they really addressing poverty? We kind of had to process everything to see that. It's through their business efforts. Another thing that we struggle with maybe is education. And in our conversation with Keith, he said that the girls don't really value education. And whether that's an issue or not, they don't want to force them into something.
And we're talking about going into like further education, moving into college and that sort of thing.
And so they view that this job and this business, especially with jewelers, is their way out rather than the typical education that I think the West thinks of as a way out of this. And so that's not necessarily a critique, but...
Culturally, I think in India, they value you get married, you have a family, you produce children. And whereas we think go to college, career, then you add on all of these things.
And finally, wondering about advocacy at a larger level. Yes, they work with like local governments and the police, but what can they do at a larger government level? And again, I don't know what that looks like in India. And you know, how much can one organization do? They're all over the place in India, and I think doing an incredible holistic mission. So
yeah. So any questions?
Let me do a little. I'd like to do a little, just take this moment and do a little teaching on issues of advocacy. And Tim's actually going to come and talk about human sex trafficking after lunch in India. So we'll kind of build on this. But a few things. This is a fascinating case study because it begins with advocacy. A lot of the other ministries start with relief and development and move to advocacy. This one actually begins with advocacy and moves to development, and even a little relief. So we're seeing shifts taking place. 10 years ago, this kind of stuff didn't happen. In fact, advocacy at all didn't happen. Now, there's lots of different kinds of advocacy. I thought, actually, Dory, your story of what you're doing with bringing people to Selma is an excellent example of advocacy. So that you're working with political figures and actually showing them what structural change looks like in a different way. This ministry and international justice ministries, their view of advocacy tends to be largely rescue based. That's not a critique, it's just saying the focus tends to be on rescue. Others like Bread for the World that I work with, they're much more focused upon structural change. It's the more prevention. And that it almost seemed like you guys were saying, high in rescue, what do they do in prevention? They're doing some.
Yeah. And it's kind of a trickle-down, I feel like, that some of what they do trickles into that. But
and I'm not at all critiquing this. I'm just trying to show you that it's a different view of advocacy. International Justice Mission, this ministry, tend to focus on advocacy as rescue. Bread for the World and World Relief, some of those, World Relief's advocacy is largely with immigration, focuses upon structural change. Now, the challenge with India is that the structural change isn't just political, it's also religious, and you guys were hinting at that. So what you'll find is a lot of these many of the prostitutes are actually temple prostitutes. So what happens is that the video explained it really accurately. Many times Dalits or tribal people who are at low caste or no caste have no way out, so they will sacrifice one or two of their girls, sell them for profit, and into the temple prostitute situation. So that one's even more complex because it's a religious issue, and with the Hindu nationalism, it's a really hard situation. The only other two other things about this ministry I thought was very significant is beauty is a really important theological theme.
Yes.
Might not be a gospel theme overtly, but I wouldn't underestimate the importance of beauty. And I thought you guys captured that really well. Making jewelry, you mean I'm actually capable of creating beauty? I mean, that sounds so simple. I actually think that's important for us to realize that we're capable of creating beauty. But these girls, it's so important. And then I thought your other point about not just caring for animals, but caring for other people is such a powerful healing metaphor. So I would include those as really strong theological themes in this. Maybe not overtly gospel focused, but I wouldn't underestimate. So when you're looking at theology, don't just look for when they talk about Jesus Christ, but look for some of these other theological themes that come out. So the only other thing that I would just mention that is a struggle with a lot of these is how do we now connect them to the church? And so I was in Hyderabad in a ministry that's largely focused upon this. It's church-based. And they shared, so these are Indian leaders who are sharing stories. They require their church planting to have once a month or so to actually host these temple prostitutes in their church, even before they're rescued, to have them come to church because they say, this is a major issue for the churches to say, you know what, we need to open our arms to these people even before they get rescued. So that, and they said it's really hard, these temple prostitutes sit over here and all the other people in the church sit over there because you've got stigmas attached to that. So how do you incorporate people like this that have gone through such horrific experiences actually into congregations? That's the next. I don't know if you saw any of that.
Well, we asked, and yeah. Nobody was really able ever to speak to it. I don't know if it's for. We didn't ask Mala in India. We asked Keith, and he talked about the integration of local churches here, local trips, and stuff like that. But
doing it there is really. I think that's the next kind of frontier is to say how do we actually get them hooked into a congregation
with the landscape changing.
I thought it'd be important just to kind of pause for a moment because I wanted to talk about advocacy today, and this is a really important example of advocacy. We have one of our doctorate ministry students, a lovely giant of a woman who's small in stature, but she's a giant of a woman, Rupa. And Tim will talk more about that, but she's actually with International Justice Mission and is helping lead International Justice Mission for the whole country. So
I believe
this is burnt out.
Mala and her husband came out of International Justice Mission, and I think they saw probably a gap in the process, and that's what inspired them to start Freedom Firm.
And there's tons of gaps. And that, again, critique doesn't mean this is a bad ministry. Critique is just saying, where are the gaps? Where are things that can be strengthened? And I think you mentioned a number of good ones. The church one, would be another one. The structural change, I think these are all issues that advocacy is incredibly complex. So, good. Well, very well done.
Offered yourself up, suffering agony, humiliation, and disgrace. The sacrifice of your life, destroying the poison within me. And you, who are the desired one, my beloved, the delight of my heart. You soothe my vision. And you, victorious crusher of cruel death.